Welcome to our second session. We're going to start off our second session with a game. You can see a set of playing cards laid out in front of me. So we're going to play a game using these playing cards. It's possible you have played this game earlier, but why not still go through it again? I'm randomly going to pick up a few cards and then we're going to perform certain operations on the number equivalent of these cards. So what do we mean by this? Suppose I pick up a card, whatever is the number equivalent. Ace would be a 1, 2 to 10 would be 2 to 10, and Jack, Queen and King would have values 11, 12 and 13 respectively. So whatever is the number equivalent of this card, suppose I pick up one more card randomly. You can now see two numbers in front of you. What you can do maybe with these two numbers, let's perform an operation, suppose we add these two numbers. So when you add these two numbers, you would get some number equivalent at the end. Now let's keep that number in mind and let's pick up yet another card. Suppose we picked up this third card and now whatever was the answer that we've received at the end of this, we divide it by this new card that we've obtained. So we had an answer, now we divide and we have an answer at the end of this second operation. Let's pick up a third card. You have a number equivalent in front of you now. Whatever was the answer at the end of this particular card, the second card, from that answer, you subtract this particular number. So we've gone through three operations, and at the end of these three operations, we have a number. Let's pick up yet another card. Whatever is the number here, you had an answer at the end of these four cards, the third operation. That number with this number you multiply. So you multiplied this number and you have a certain answer at the end of these cards. Let's randomly pick up one more card. Whatever is this number, what you can now do is the answer that you had obtained, you add this particular value and you obtain a certain number at the end of it. Now we don't want to make this an endless activity, so let's pick up a final card. And whatever is this particular number, you multiply this number to the answer at the end of all the operations that you had earlier. At the end of this operation, finally, you would get a certain answer. With that value, if it's more than one digit, which it should be, then you add up all the digits of that number till you eventually end up with a single digit number. If you add up all the digits and you still end up with a two digit or a three digit number, you continue the addition process of the digits till you eventually end up with one single digit. If you have done all that, the digit that you end up with should be 9. If you're surprised, you will understand why this happened as we move along this session. And if you've already played this game, then maybe you are aware of why we ended up with 9. But just hold on for a little while. We'll go through our session and then somewhere down the line, we'll explain how you ended up with a 9 with these few operations. We'll now move on from the game. As already mentioned, the game was based on this concept called divisibility tests. And we're going to now study what are these divisibility tests. We're We'll now move on beyond the game. As I had already mentioned earlier, the game was based on the concept of divisibility tests. What do we really mean by divisibility tests? Divisibility tests actually tell you how to check if a number is divisible by some other number. So we're going to look at divisibility tests for various numbers and we're going to break it up into parts. We're going to start off with numbers which are powers of 2. So if I want to check if a number is divisible by 2, how would I check that? It's a very simple test. I only need to check the units digit of the number. If the units digit of the number is divisible by 2, or if it is a 0, then the entire number would be divisible by 2. So my divisibility test for 2 is based only on my units digit. If my units digit is any one of 0, 2, 4, 6 or 8, then this number would be divisible by 2. While we are studying divisibility test, we are also going to have a look at remainder test, which would mean how do we find the remainder when a number is divided by 2. Now for 2, it is a very, very simple procedure. If the number is not divisible by 2, then the remainder has to be 1. So remainder test for 2 is very simple. Either the number is divisible by 2 or the remainder has to be 1. Let's move on to another power of 2. And let's check the divisibility test for 4. If my divisibility test for 2 was based only on the units digit, my divisibility test for 4 is only based on the last 2 digits of the number, which would mean take the last 2 digits of the number, whatever is the number formed, divide that number by 4. If that number is divisible by 4, then my entire number is divisible by 4. The other possibility is that the number formed by the last 2 digits would be 0, 0. So if the last 2 digits are zeros, or if the number formed by the last 2 digits is divisible by 4, then my number is divisible by 4. Just as we check the remainder test for 2, we would also check the remainder test for 4. We don't need to divide the entire number by 4 and find the remainder. You just divide the number formed by the last 2 digits by 4. So if the number formed by the last 2 digits, let's assume an example of 35. If the number formed by the last 2 digits is 35, then the remainder, when I divide 35 by 4, would be 3. And hence, even if 35 forms a part of a 10-digit number as the last 2 digits, this 10-digit number, when divided by 4, would end up with a remainder of 3. Moving on to another power of 2, suppose I say test for 8. You will notice that the test for 2 depended on the last digit, test for 4 depended on the last 2 digits, and hence the test for 8 would depend on the last 3 digits. And we can continue in this manner for higher powers of 2. So for 8, if the number formed by the last 3 digits is divisible by 8, or if that number is 0, 0, 0, then my entire number would be divisible by 8. And remainder test would again follow the same pattern. Take the number formed by the last 3 digits and divide that by 8. Whatever is the remainder, same would be the remainder when the entire number is divided by 8. We have already understood the divisibility test for all numbers which are powers of 2. We've just taken the first 4 powers of 2, but we've looked at the divisibility test for 2, 4, 8 and 16. Let's now move on to numbers which are powers of 3. So let's take the first power of 3, which means if I have to check the divisibility test for 3, it's one of the simplest rules actually. All that we do is add up all the digits of the number. We just find the sum of the digits, and if the sum of the digits of the number is divisible by 3, then the overall number is also divisible by 3. Moving on to remainder test for 3, how do we find the remainder when a number is divided by 3? We just continue with this. The sum of the digits that we have found, if it is not divisible by 3, and hence which means that the number is not divisible by 3, just divide the sum of the digits by 3 and check the remainder. Whatever is the remainder would be the same remainder when the entire number is divided by 3. If we move on to another power of 3, suppose I write down the divisibility test for 9. The rule remains the same. We again check the sum of the digits, and if the sum of the digits of the number is divisible by 9, then the entire number is divisible by 9. The remainder test for 9 would again remain the same. Just divide the sum of the digits of the number by 9 and check the remainder. The remainder would remain the same when the entire number is also divided by 9. We've already seen divisibility test for powers of 2 and divisibility test for powers of 3. Let's now move on to divisibility test for powers of 5. So let's assume we are looking at test for 5 itself, which means how do we know if a number is divisible by 5? Very simple. Divide the units digit by 5. If the units digit of the number is divisible by 5, then the entire number is divisible by 5. Specifically for this case, it's a very simple procedure. If my unit digit is 5 or 0, then the number is divisible by 5. If I move on to the remainder test for 5, I would again use only the unit digit for the remainder. And for the remainder test, it would be divide the unit digit by 5 and check the remainder. If that unit digit is less than 5, whatever is the unit digit will itself be the remainder. And if my unit digit is more than 5, then you divide the unit digit by 5 and find the remainder. Moving on to a higher power of 5. Suppose I want the test for 25. Since for 5, my test was dependent only on the unit digit, now for 25, my test would be dependent on the last two digits. So we divide the last two digits, the number formed by the last two digits, by 25. And if it is divisible, or if the last two digits happen to be 00, then the entire number is divisible by 25. So there are only four possibilities for the last two digits. The last two digits can be 25, 50, 75, or 00. In either of these cases, or in any of these cases, the entire number would be divisible by 25. And the remainder test would follow the same logic. If I take yet another power of 5, suppose I look at the test for 125, following the pattern, we now take the last 3 digits of the number. If the number formed by the last 3 digits is divisible by 125, or if the last 3 digits are zeros, then the entire number would be divisible by 125. So this entire logic of unit digit, last 2 digits, last 3 digits, we can move on in this logic for higher powers of 5 also. Let's now move on to a few other numbers. We look at a few prime numbers. Let me start with divisibility test for 11. And divisibility test for 11, let's start off with an example, and I will explain the divisibility test with respect to this example. Suppose I have a number 37851. In divisibility test for 11, what we need to do is, we need to add up the alternate digits. So when I look at these alternate digits, they are 3, 8 and 1, and the sum of these 3 digits, it adds up to 12. Let's now look at the other possibility of alternate digits. You have 7 and 5, and these two also add up to 12. So in divisibility test for 11, you find the sum of alternate digits and you will get two such sums. The difference between these two sums should be either 0 or it should be a multiple of 11. In this example 37851, we notice that the difference between these two sums of the alternate digits is 0. Hence, this number would be divisible by 11. Let's look at another example where maybe the difference between these two sums is not 0. So let's take up a number 72831. If we now look at the difference between the two sums, we first take the alternate digits and the sum of these three digits would be 16. And when I take these two alternate digits, the sum would be 5. The difference between these two sums is now 11. So hence, such a number is also divisible by 11. So just to recap, when we start with divisibility test for 11, we add up the alternate digits, we get two such sums, and the difference between these two sums of the alternate digits should either be 0 or it should be a multiple of 11. In either of these two cases, the number would be divisible by 11. So we've looked at the divisibility test for 11. We'll now move on to the divisibility test for 19. Let's look at the test for 19. And let's take an example, 1083. The divisibility test for 19 can be stated as twice the unit's digit plus the remaining number. What do we mean by that? If we separate it out and we consider the unit digits separately, then we can see that 3 would be the unit digit in this example, and the remaining number would be 108. So we take 2 times the unit digit plus 108, which gives us 114. The test would mean that if this number is divisible by 19, then the entire number is divisible by 19. And it's possible that after this stage 1, we still are not in a position to check whether this is divisible by 19 or not. So we can just repeat this step for the new number formed. And hence we would now take it as twice the unit digit 4 plus the remaining part of the number, which is 11. And hence it becomes 8 plus 11, which is 19. Obviously this number is divisible by 19, and hence the original number 1083 is divisible by 19. So the rule for 19 would be twice the unit digit plus the remaining number, if we ignore the unit digit, should be divisible by 19. This is the divisibility test for 19. We can use this logic of 19 and we can identify tests for 7, 13 and 17. The logic is similar. It would be a certain value multiplied by the units digit plus the remaining number. The only difference between 19 and these other three numbers would be this particular value, which will not be 2, but it will be some other value. And it's not difficult to compute this new value. So I would request you to try out a few examples and arrive at what would be this value for 7, what would be this value for 13, and what would be this value for 17. The rule would remain the same, that certain value multiplied by the unit digit plus the remaining number should be divisible by either 7 or 13 or 17, depending on which rule we are checking. Moving on with a few more divisibility tests, we will now look at numbers which can be broken up into two numbers which are co-prime or relatively prime. So let's look at divisibility test for 12. If we look at this number 12, we can break up this number into two parts, for example 3 and 4. So the divisibility test for 12 would very simply be that if a number is divisible by 3 and by 4, and we've already gone through the divisibility test for 3 and 4, then this entire number would be divisible by 12. Similarly, you can have the divisibility test for 15. If this number is divisible by 3 and 5, the number that we are considering, if that is divisible by 3 and 5, then the number is divisible by 15. Yet another example could be divisibility test for 18. If a number is divisible by 2 and 9, then the number is divisible by 18. Another way of stating this could be, any even number divisible by 9 is divisible by 18. So we could have a lot of such examples. We can also maybe consider, which we missed out earlier, test for 6. If a number is divisible by 2 and 3, then the number is divisible by 6. So any number which can be broken up into two parts which are relatively prime, we can just ensure if the number is divisible by both the parts, then the number will always be divisible by the product. The only rule is that the two parts that we consider should be relatively prime.